بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Respected elders, dear brothers and sisters, my young friends, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Most of us have probably heard the story of the boy who cried wolf. This boy was said to be a shepherd, and he was bored minding his sheep. So one day he decided that he would cry wolf and see the response of the villagers. So he started crying out, "Wolf, wolf, wolf." So the villagers were caring people. So they heard of his cries and they thought of the destruction that the wolves or wolf may bring upon his herd of sheep. So they came running in his defense. And what did they find? They find the boy laughing, enjoying the fact that he had tricked the villagers and had some humor for his otherwise boring day. But that wasn't all. So the second time around, the shepherd decided to do the same thing. And once again, he cried out, "Wolf, wolf, wolf." And again, the people, the villagers, they were so kind and compassionate that they once again decided to give him a chance and said, "Okay, well, maybe he erred the first time. Now perhaps he's telling the truth, so let us go and help him and protect his sheep." And once again, they found the same thing, that he's laughing and enjoying the moment, that once again, he has tricked the people. So as we know, the story goes, the third time around, again, he decides to do the same thing, but this time no one comes. And the third time around, he's actually doing it for real, because now there really is a wolf. But he had proven himself a liar. He had proven himself a liar, and the third time around, no one was ready to give him a chance. And they all felt that if he has lied the first time, and then we gave him a chance and he lied the second time, most chances are he's also lying the third time, and we're not going to be fooled this time. But they were wrong, because he actually was telling the truth now. But it was too late, because of the reputation that he had built for himself, and the trust that had been broken, the trust that had been lost. So this, of course, is a lesson on some of the practical implications of lying. Of course, there are many other harms, spiritually as well and practically, in this world and in the next. And we know about this already. But what I'd like to talk to you about today is that sometimes there are situations when the opposite is also true. Sometimes there are situations when the opposite is also true. Sometimes a person is truly honest and truthful in their claim, yet no one is ready to believe them. And not just believe, but at times people also actively speak against them, calling them a liar, a fabricator, a conspirator, or conspirer, an evil person, someone who's mentally deranged, and so on and so forth. There are numerous examples when people come up with various accusations against a person, even though that person may actually be true in their claim. And this depends on the type of claim that is being made and the circumstances. It could be as simple as a car crash in which you are not at fault, but the other party makes up a story to make it seem as if it was your fault, to put the blame on you so that you are found to be at fault. And perhaps there is an incident that has occurred to you, and this especially happens, unfortunately and very sadly, to victims of abuse, and particular types of abuse especially. So an incident has occurred, something has happened to you and you have been wronged, but you don't say anything because you fear that people will not believe you, especially if the perpetrator is a person of power. And unfortunately, such circumstances occur. They happen outside of our community. They happen in our communities. They happen in Muslim societies. Yet there is a veil of silence that is imposed upon victims, even though they are perfectly true many times, perfectly legitimate claims, but many times those claims are not allowed to be made due to pressure to maintain the silence and not disrupt the status quo. Or perhaps on the flip side, there are also times when there are false accusations. So perhaps there is a false accusation against you and you're unable to defend yourself from those accusations because, let's say, there are no eyewitnesses. Or perhaps the circumstantial evidence suggests that you might be guilty and there's no one to back you up. So sometimes there's a series of events, a sequence of events, of circumstances that put a person in a situation where it is very easy to make a false accusation against them. And this person may be clean, they may be perfectly innocent, but there's no one else there. And the accusation is made, and they're not able to defend themselves. We even find cases of wrongful convictions, not just in other parts of the world, but even here in Canada as well, in a country that is generally known to be fair and just. But there are miscarriages of justice. There have been people who have spent years, even decades, in prison for crimes that they did not commit. In many cases, it was the discovery and admissibility of DNA evidence which cleared their names 20, 30, 40 years later. Can you imagine? SubhanAllah. Being in prison for that long, knowing that you did not commit that crime, and also knowing that the entire world believes that you did it, or almost everyone believes that you did it, even though you hadn't. Or perhaps, in at least one case, we know that there was an expert witness who turned out to be a liar, who was making up conclusions which were not true. Or perhaps it's an experience that you go through, or something that you witness, but it is uncommon, or it is something which is not commonly recognized, and people doubt your story just because it's uncommon to hear such claims. Sometimes we refer to it as paranormal activity. Paranormal activity. So something sometimes that has to do with jinns and has to do with black magic perhaps, or simply it's a manifestation of the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that is not commonly seen or commonly known. And this truly happened to you, but you tell people and they doubt your story, or they reject it outright. My brothers and sisters, when we look back, we find numerous examples of the above. First and foremost are the examples of pretty much all, if not most, or pretty much most, if not all of the prophets, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. They were all sincere, and we know this and we believe this, that they were all sincere and honest people. And they truly did receive revelations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah azza wa jalla also gave them miracles to prove or to indicate or to back up their truthfulness and their claims. Yet, they were still rejected by their people. And not only were they rejected, they were cursed, they were threatened, and they were given all types of hurtful labels and names. We find the story of Sayyidatuna Maryam alayha salam, who was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Mary, the mother of Jesus alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, who was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no doing of her own. You can imagine what that must have felt like. It's not that she wanted this, or she asked for it, or she desired it, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to give her this elevated rank, and with that came this tribe, where she presents herself to her people with this young newborn baby, Isa, Jesus, alayhi salam. And she knows that the people will doubt her story. And that's what they did. And they don't only, you know, they don't just doubt, but they make malicious accusations against her and give her a guilt trip about something in which there was no fault of hers, and rather it was an honor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find the story of Ya'qub alayhi salam, who was lied to by his sons, and then has his extreme sorrow of losing first Yusuf alayhi salam, and then briefly as well his other son, known as Binyamin. While knowing all this time that his other sons are trying to fool him, even though they themselves don't realize that their father knows something that they do not, right, or knows what they're trying to hide. Yet he lives with that pain and the grief of this tragedy upon tragedy upon tragedy. Then Yusuf alayhi salam himself, falsely accused of attempting to assault and harass the wife of Aziz, and he himself is wrongfully imprisoned for years. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, numerous instances where he's belied by his people, by the people of Makkah, his own relatives, his own tribesmen, people who believed even that he was truthful, and they acknowledged that he was truthful and honest in the beginning. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam presented to them the truth, they rejected him. Beginning from the revelation in the cave of Hira, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was absolutely truthful in what he had seen and what he had then shared. We have the night journey of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam traveled from Makkah al-Mukarrama to Al-Baytul Maqdis to Jerusalem, and then to the heavens and back. And again, when he relayed what had happened, he was belied and mocked by the people of Makkah. Now, Aisha radiallahu anha, long, tragic incident. If you get a chance, do try to read that narration, where Aisha radiallahu anha relates in first person the story of, or the incident of Al-Ifk. Very tragic. So these are just a few examples, and there's many, many more examples of people who were upon the truth, and they were belied, they were rejected, they were not believed. My brothers and sisters, such trials can be extremely stressful, naturally, understandably, and extremely demoralizing as well. Right? When you know that you're upon the truth, when you know yourself that what you're saying is true, and yet no one is willing to accept your story, your claim, and on top of that, they're saying that you're a liar, and you're making up stories, and especially when it's people who are close to you, that is extremely painful. That is an experience that can be extremely traumatizing, extremely painful. So what should be our approach? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. But if we come across, or if we are, let's put it this way, if we are tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with such circumstances, then what should be our approach? So let us try to take some lessons from a few of these incidents that we read about and that we have discussed. So first of all, before anything happens, from the very beginning, and this is something we should be encouraging our children with as well, that from the very beginning, we should try to build a reputation of honesty and trustworthiness. From the very beginning. Right? Because the Prophet ﷺ, even before there was any thought or inclination of prophethood, from a very young age, he built up this reputation that everyone knew that he was a sadiq and al-amin, that he was the truthful and the trustworthy. So this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands of us, that we be truthful and honest. And at the same time, this is something that can also help us. Because this should be the character of a Muslim, that we are honest and truthful, and we build up that reputation from day one, from a very young age. Secondly, try to build a group, a close group of people around you who can attest to your truthfulness. People who are close to you and who know firsthand that you are a truthful person. You see, the Prophet ﷺ went to Khadija radiallahu anha after the beginning of revelation. That's the first person he went to. And she embraced him, and she comforted him. And she did not for one second doubt his claim. Rather, she reassured the Prophet ﷺ. And she was the one who then took him to Waraqa bin Nawfal, her cousin, a Bible scholar, well versed in the books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent before the Qur'an. And he verified that the incident, the experience that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had lived was in fact a true revelation. The same revelation, the same angel that had come to prophets in the past. After the journey of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, the people came because they were in disbelief, and they were not just in disbelief, but they were clearly, you know, in outright rejection mode, and in a mode of mockery as well. So not just rejection, but mockery with it. So they came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu before he got the title of as-Siddiq. He came to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and they said, هل لك في صاحبك يزعم أنه أسري في الليل إلى بيت المقدس. Look at what your companion is saying. Look at your companion. He says he went to Bayt al-Maqdis, to Jerusalem, and came back in this night journey, right? In a mocking tone, in a challenging, mocking tone, putting Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu on the spot, that you believe in what this person is saying, your friend, your companion here. And look what he's saying now. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu asks, أَوَ قَالَ ذَلِكَ. Has he said this? Has he actually said what you're saying? And he said, نعم. Yes, he has. Look at the response of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. لَإِنْ كَانَ قَالَ ذَلِكَ لَقَدْ صَدَقْ. That if he said that, then he is truthful. If he has said it, then he is truthful. That's it. No ifs or buts. If the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said it, then he is truthful. And he actually went on and said that I believe him concerning the news of the heavens, that an angel descends to him from the heavens So how could I not believe that he went to Jerusalem and came back in a short period of time when these are on earth? And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu bin got the title of Siddiq. The one who is truthful, a passionate pursuer of the truth, a true person of truth. Thirdly, my brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, but if you find yourself in such a situation, then tell the truth as is, even in the face of opposition. Even if you are opposed, tell the truth as it is. The only exception perhaps is if you truly fear for your life. If it's a matter of life and death, then in that case, perhaps you do what is best at that time. But otherwise, even in the face of opposition, tell the truth as it is. Whatever it is, tell it as it happens, in a calm manner. In which way? In a calm manner. Do not hide the truth, or be intimidated, or become frustrated, because it is very easy to become frustrated when you are not believed, even though you know you are telling the truth. And by all means, do not become unruly or become violent, because that will weaken your case. So just continue to stand firm upon what is true and stick to it. Fourthly, recognize that if it's your word against another person's word, because in many cases that is what happens. It's person A versus person B. And there's no other witnesses. So it's one claim against the other. Recognize that in this case, the person who is more widely known, more widely accepted, widely liked, or who has more power, is likely going to be believed. If it's my word against someone else's word, people will most likely believe the person they perceive to be more credible, or that they are familiar with, or that they know. Okay, and that's just the reality of it. Reality of it, so don't be surprised by this. It's not to say that it's right, it's not. But don't be surprised. And don't be intimidated either. Don't be intimidated either. And sometimes your family might even doubt your story, as was the case in the incident of Aisha radiallahu anha, where perhaps, you know, let me rephrase that. Perhaps they didn't doubt her story, but they were unsure on how to handle the circumstances. And because there were no eyewitnesses, it was very difficult for people to take a stand. But Aisha radiallahu anha knew that she was upon the truth. She knew that. She was 100% certain about that, and she stuck to it. And finally, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your witness. Allah azza wa jalla is your witness, even if your family doubts your story, or cannot believe, or does not understand exactly what has happened. If people refuse to make judgments, if they are looking down upon you, but you know you are upon the truth, then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your witness, and turn to Him. And have comfort in knowing that Allah Azza wa Jalla is always watching. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant justice. This is one of the great comforts that the believers have. That the world and our life and our existence, well, the world certainly will end, but our existence will not. We will die in this world a bodily death, but our soul's existence will continue. And justice will be served. If it is not served in this dunya, many cases it is even served in this life, in this world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides, sometimes it happens very quickly. And you're just amazed that this was a case I was fighting, this was something I was pushing for, and I was facing pushback, and there were all these circumstances, and boom. 1 minute, 1 day, everything changes. And you get justice. But that doesn't always happen. Sometimes it comes later on. Sometimes people pass away and they do not see justice in their life. This happens to many people. But as believers, we know that there will be a day of justice. And everyone will get their fair share. And all disputes and all forms of oppression will be settled, whether it's individual or communal. It will all be settled one day. And everyone will be dealt with justly. Aisha radiallahu anha says regarding that incident that I was still a young girl at that time when the slanderous accusations were made against her. And she found that there was a lack of support from pretty much everyone around her. And that no one was fully supporting her 100%. She says, I was still a young girl at that time and had not memorized much of the Quran. So I could not remember the name of the father of Yusuf, alayhi salam. So she said, I know by Allah, so she's addressing her family members, people who are close to her. I know by Allah that you have heard these rumors and that these rumors have settled into your heart and soul and you have believed it already. So if I were to tell you that I'm not guilty, you wouldn't believe me. You would not believe me. And if I were to admit to a crime that I did not commit, then you will believe me and think that I did it. So all I can say to you is what the father of Yusuf alayhi salam said, sabrun jameen, patience, it's beautiful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help is sought concerning what you described. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then cleared her name by revealing a number of verses, Surah An-Nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from becoming a perpetrator of falsehood and a victim of falsehood. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect and grant justice to all of those who are innocent. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the truth clear to us at all times. May Allah azza wa jalla make us truthful and people who are recognized as being truthful. Ameen.